Welcome back, church. I hope you enjoyed last week's study on light, love, and life. I hope you learned something when we spoke about actually the light of Christ. And as we continue on this study, we're on day two on the study, and we're going to journey through the Gospel of 1 John, right? And I think God's going to show us something amazing today, because there's something beautiful that, you know, I was even going through it just before today, and God was really speaking to me and challenging me. You know, through these studies, something is that we got to learn is this. Actually, a lot of the questions that I ask is actually a reflection of asking ourselves the same thing, right? So today's scripture base is actually on 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 to 6. 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 to 6. If you read it, it'll come up on your screens. And what it says: now by this we know that we know him, if we keep his commandments. He who says, I know him, and does not keep his commandments, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, truly the love of God is perfected in him. By this we know that we are in him. He who says he abides in him ought himself also to walk just as he walked. See, it's talking a lot about this abiding, being, knowing God, following his commandments, right? See, the first question we need to ask ourselves is, do I really know my Savior well enough to say that I have divine intimacy? Right? Divine intimacy with the Father is something very important, and something which you and I, a Christian, sometimes neglect it as well. See, I don't know how many of you are in a relationship, maybe with your girlfriend or your boyfriend, or you're married that's watching this right now. You know what intimacy means, right? You know about how well do you know your spouse. If I ask you that, how well do you know your spouse, you would have many answers. You'll know what her likes are, what he or she dislikes are. Probably you know what the favorite color is, what she likes to wear. Or, you know, so many little, sometimes minute details, you would know more than sometimes her friends or anyone else would, right? See, through this, what we are trying to, I want to tell you is, you must try to make an effort to understand and know the innermost desires of God's heart. What are the innermost desires of God's heart, right? And also, to understand what's going on in his heart. See, in a relationship, it's not a one-way thing, right? Do you have that closeness with God? Are you sensitive to the Spirit of God? Are you God's dwelling place? If you look at Psalms 91, verse 1, it states beautifully in that, in Psalms 1, verse 91, it says, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. So he who dwells in the secret place of who? The Most High. It doesn't say, I'm sure your Bible doesn't say, he who dwells in the people shall abide under the shadow of and the influence of the people. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. See, first of all, we need to get our dwelling place sorted out. Where is your dwelling place? Where is my dwelling place? Is it in people or is it in God? See, we need to make sure that our dwelling place, our secret place, is in the heart of the Most High God. That if we are not close to his heart, then how do we know the deeper secrets that are within him? And then it's that how we develop intimacy with God. It's then that we abide under the shadow of the Almighty. How does a shadow happen? You know, if you go to a studio or something like that, there's so many lights trying to take away the shadow, right? But if you walk in the sun, if you walk out in the daylight, right, you find the shadow always behind, isn't it? Unless you say the sun is rising from behind and you walk in front of it, then the shadow is in front. But to be in the shadow, you have to be close to the person. isn't it? To be in the shadow of someone, there is a closeness that you have to be. And that is intimacy. The way God moves, the way He moves, is how we need to move to fit into His shadow. God doesn't fit into our shadow. Most of us want that from God. We want Him to fit into what we are doing. But we don't take time to know what is God's heart in all of this. Where is God's heart? See, which brings me to my second question of reflection. Am I making an effort to obey God's commandments so that divine revelation is given to me as a result of my obedience? Or is my disobedience hindering me from knowing God intimately? See, you got to ask God, you got to ask yourself, not ask God, you got to ask yourself, is the Word of God daily bread or is it a cake? You might think, why? What does cake have to do with this? See, daily bread is something you have daily. A cake is something you bring out only on an occasion. So divine revelation is not given to those whose minds are shut off from the commandments of God. Right? They can think they can do whatever they like because they live under the grace of God. Deeper revelation, if you want deeper revelation of God's word, it comes through obedience. See, if I am to think that the commandments of God are for those and not for me, only for those out there and not for me, then I will walk through life never actually knowing God intimately. See, when you are in a relationship, there are rules and regulations in that relationship, isn't it? You cannot just live the way you like and be in a relationship. Correct? If you are in a relationship with a spouse, with your spouse in marriage, there are boundaries and rules in that marriage that you need to abide by. If you don't abide by that, that means what? You don't respect that relationship. You don't honor that relationship. You don't have intimacy. See, when you hear the word commandments, you think, oh, the law. But what I'm talking about, your relationship with God, your relationship with Jesus, there are boundaries you need to abide by. That is what I'm talking about. Isn't it when you are married to your spouse, there are particular rules and regulations you put out. To your family, your kids, there are rules and regulations in the house that need to be followed. It's not because you hate them, no, because you love them, there are certain things that you follow. So it's the same thing when it comes to the things of God. We have boundaries, we have regulations, we have principles we need to set. It's very important, church. See, since God is spirit, He also can make things known of Himself to a greater extent to those spirit man who is growing and developing in line. His thoughts and ways. See, when we walk in the spirit, as God is a spirit, He can reveal greater things to us. Right? See, if not, what happens? The deeper things of God will sound like foolishness to us. Why? Because our spirit man is not matured. But when our spirit man is matured, how does it mature? Through divine intimacy. How do marriages mature? Through years of intimacy, understanding each other, following the rules and regulations, following this, abiding in each other. What happens? Your marriage becomes mature. So it doesn't matter what anyone can come and say, your relationship stands strong, you won't fall apart. Why? Because it has matured. In the same way, in our relationship with God, I want to ask you, is your relationship with God in a place of maturity, or is it in a place of, you know, like a seedling, which can be snuffed off for anything? A strong wind comes, that seedling will pull out of the ground and go. So you must be asking, Pastor, how do I mature my relationship with God? It is through divine intimacy, through spending time with God, following His commandments, living that righteous life which God has given to us as a gift. is how we mature our relationship with God. See, my next question is, am I lying to myself by saying that I know God, but disobeying Him and doing whatever I please? See, when others lie to us, we feel hurt, isn't it? We feel disappointed. And we never ever want to trust that person again. We might get angry with that person. Because why? He deceived us, he cheated us with all his lies. We get so mad and upset. But what happens when we lie to our own self? When we say we know God, but instead we do everything that the devil tells us, we actually lie to ourselves and deceive our very own soul. Think about it. Take a moment and think, am I lying to myself? You may come and say, you know, I know God, I know this, I know that. But do you actually know God? See, sometimes we obey the call of the world and try to please everyone around us just to keep our friendship and relationship. Self-deception can make a fool of you for a very long time and cause you to miss out on the great blessing and good things that God has planned for and to give you. Sometimes we are so focused on maintaining our friendship and relationship of the world and so less focused on building that relationship and friendship with God. We take that as secondary, and our primary focus is making sure our friendship and relationships with people are maintained. But we are not much focused on having that, maintaining that relationship and friendship with God. But you know God. It's a good question to ask yourself. See, as a percentage, how much of my spirit man has God's truth in it? And how much of it is man-made, self-made beliefs? I'm going to ask that question again. As a percentage, how much of your spirit man has God's truth in it? And how much of it has man-made and self-made beliefs? We need to have a self-evaluation and see. Our knowledge of the Word of God, is it man-made thoughts and doctrines? And how much of it is personal beliefs about God's Word? Is everything that you know and believe man-made thoughts, or is it your personal belief, or is it what the Word of God actually is telling you? See, according to Hebrews 10:25, if God had commanded us to meet together regularly to worship Him, then what is my belief about it? Let's turn to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. We look at that. No, I didn't put it on the screen. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together, as in the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. So what is it talking about here is the getting together to worship God regularly. See, some people, what do they think? They're supposed to think, you know, it's not necessary to go to church or meet with other Christians on a regular basis. Instead, I can watch the sermon online, you know. Or I say, God is in my heart. I have my own church. I am the church of Christ. I read the Bible. I pray at home. So is that enough? Or do you make a conscious effort to physically meet together with other believers as often as possible so that you fulfill the requirement of the unity of the body of Christ? Because why do you do that? If not, the enemy is beautifully bringing in, and you are being deceived by the devil, and fall into the trap of division and alienation. See, the Father, Son, and Spirit are one. And therefore, it is important that we too demonstrate the oneness in united worship by physically meeting together and not finding excuses. You know, the enemy beautifully bought in COVID, and you know, during COVID, a lot of people got stuck in their home for a long period of time due to lockdown. And what happened? That lifestyle became so comfortable. Why? The easy option. Now, churches have all gone with live stream and online and everything. The easy option is to sit at home and I'll watch the service. I'll participate with it online. I'm not saying it's wrong. It's good. It's okay. But what does God command us to do? Get together and worship God physically. So there is an importance when God says it, then we got to obey. Like I said, obedience is key in relationships. In intimacy, obedience is key. So it's important that you and I make a conscious effort to meet regularly and come together in worship. See, we take in coming to church as a very easy, today is not a good day. I got a bit of a cold. I'll stay behind. So, you know, I had a late night. So, you know what? I'll watch online. I know what the sermon was. You know the sermon. You know everything. But make a conscious effort, church. This year, 2023, as Pastor Raja mentioned, the year of his house. Let us make a conscious effort to come together to his house, to worship together. It's important. You might not like me today when I'm saying this to you. You may have got so comfortable watching everything online. You may be following the Father's House Church every Sunday. You don't miss it. You watch it every day online. You know, you have your own prayer time. You do all that. But it is important when God's Word says we need to come together. Then are you obeying what God has commanded? Why are you going to disobey, saying, you know what, I don't need to go. I follow it. I do my own prayer. I am my own church. No. You got to come together. It's very important. Sorry. Next question is, do I demonstrate my love for God by obeying his commands with regard to worship, time spent in prayer and in the word, with regard to my speech, behavior, attitude, character, temperament, choice of attire, friendships, relationship, and the way I serve God? So through all that is how you demonstrate your love for God. See, just like we would go for a medical checkup on and off sometime, once a year you might be going for a medical checkup to see how your heart is doing, check your sugar levels, your cholesterol, blood pressure, you know, all that. It's most important to check our progress of our character and our commitment to God. If I ask you to do a checkup on 2022 of your character and your commitment to God, what would your score be? It's very important to evaluate. You know, if you're a business person watching today, you know how important evaluation is. If you are a trainer or a person who does lectures, it's very important to evaluate and see how you did it. Did it accomplish what it needs to accomplish, or did it not? Because why? That's how you learn where your mishaps are, what didn't go well, or what could I have done better. But in our Christian walk with God, we don't take time to evaluate ourselves. Hey, how much time that last year did I spend with God? How much time did I spend learning his word? How much time did I spend worshiping? Okay, through all that, how well has my character grown? Has my behavior changed? Is my attitude changed? Is my temperament changed? Has my attire changed? Has my friendships changed? How I serve God, has it changed? Do I find more zeal to serve God? These are questions, church, you need to ask yourself. See, we need to at least on a quarterly basis see whether we are progressing or whether there are blocks. See, if your heart has a block, you will have to undergo a bypass, isn't it? But if you delay that treatment and surgery, you might pass by to the other side of the life and end up in glory land. So you got to evaluate, check. There might be blocks. Maybe when you evaluate and see, hey, I haven't spent much time reading His Word. I haven't spent much time studying. I haven't spent much time, you know, doing this. But I've spent so much time with the things of the world. See, a lot of us invest in our career, invest into our future, invest into our livelihood, in our thing. But how many of you are investing in building God's kingdom, investing in a relationship with God? How many of you invest in your spouse? In a relationship you are with, you invest in the opposite person. Why? To show how much you love them. You'll invest in them. You'll buy things for them that they like. But when it comes to things of God, when it comes to our relationship with God, we cannot invest anything. Why? When it comes to serving God, we find it very hard to commit and do things. We want to do it leisurely, at convenience. When I can, let me do it. If I can't, I can't. Imagine you tell that to your spouse. Oh, when I can, I'll come home today. If I can't, I can't. No. You'll make it happen. Why? The relationship with your spouse is important. You wouldn't want anything to break that up. If you need to tell your boss and go home early, you will do it. Why? For you, the relationship with your spouse is important. But when it comes to our relationship with God, I know that's okay. God understands. God knows. And we take it so easy when it comes to things of God. See, taking the above thing which I shared with you about, you know, your attitude and your career, your character, and you're evaluating yourself. Am I actually in union with God, or am I in union with people trying to please them? Or am I in union with myself trying to satisfy all my desires? I want to accomplish everything I want to. It doesn't matter if I can accomplish what God wants me to do. See, it takes time, and just search your soul and see. Are you having a divine intimacy with God, your creator? The one who created you? The one who gave you the breath of life? If I'd ask you to have a percentage out of 100%, what percentage would be your relationship with God? What percentage is your relationship with others and self? Evaluate yourself and see. Is it a 10% relationship with God and a 90% relationship with others and self? Or is it a 25% with God and a 75% with the relationship with others and self? Or is it 70% relationship with God, a 30% relationship with others and self? How is your weight going? If you have a chart, if you do an evaluation, how would you evaluate yourself? Is your relationship with others and yourself more important than your relationship with God? Which would describe you most? See, the final question I want to ask you is your spirit man dwelling in God, or is it abiding in people, situations, problems, and circumstances? Where exactly is your spirit dwelling? Psalms 91:1. What does it say? He who dwells in the secret place shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. All of us want to be under the shadow of the Almighty God. All of us want the blessings of the Almighty God. But we do not want to dwell in His secret place. See, stop making excuses of your sins and weaknesses. Ask God to transform you into a person who is accountable and responsible for your own actions. Be courageous to address your spirit man and speak to yourself. Call yourself by name. Tell yourself the areas you need to change. Because when you start speaking to your soul, you can speak to your soul, you know. You can address it, you can speak to your soul. It begins to receive the words of truth. And it goes into action. See, we're going to do a little exercise. We're going to speak to our soul right now. And as the prayer comes up, the blank will be where you mention your name. And you're speaking to your soul and you're going to tell your soul, you know what? Enough. 2022 is over. The lifestyle I lived in 2022, I don't want it to carry into 2023. 2023, I want to build an intimate relationship with Jesus. I want to serve God wholeheartedly. I want to come together in worship, in unity with others. I want my character to change. I want that ability. You know, Pastor Raja last Sunday beautifully shared to us who we are and how we need to be dressed, our attire. So many things were taught to us. How many of you take that and actually apply it in your lives is very important. Because it's through application of the knowledge that is given to you from the platform on the Word of God. That is using wisdom. When you apply it into your life and you start living that life, that is the most important thing. So look and see, church. Just evaluate your life. How much time have you invested into building a relationship with God? How much time have you invested in building a relationship with others and yourself? Accomplishing the desires of others, accomplishing the desires of yourself, and accomplishing the desires of God. You put all those three, what would be the percentage you are spending in each one of that? The life God has given you for a day, even if you say 24 hours God has given you, out of that 24 hours, how much time do you invest in building a relationship with God, building a relationship with friends and others, and building a relationship with you and about yourself? Evaluate. Question yourself and see. Put things right. Don't let 2023 go by as 2022 went. Make some life changes. So when you come to the end of 2023, you can look back and when you evaluate, you can say, you know what? My relationship with God has gone to another level. I have built a divine intimacy with God. I learned to abide in the secret place of the Most High. That is important. See, we can read the Word of God, we can pray, we can do all that. But if we don't have a relationship with God, those two are nothing. Because the Pharisees read the word, they prayed, but nothing happened. They knew the word from cover to cover. They knew all the prayers, they did everything, but there was nothing. Why? What was missing? The relationship with God. So that is important, church. So as we go into this part, I want to do this one with you guys, where the words will come up on the screen, and wherever that blank comes, I want you to put your name And we're going to read it out together. Slowly, as we read it, put your name there. And let's read together. Timothy, it's time you stopped being a hypocrite. What are we doing is we're speaking to our soul right now. So really slowly, audibly, just mention and pray this with me. Just read this with me. Timothy, it is time you stop being a hypocrite. Get your act together. Timothy, you need to stop pretending to be a good Christian for others to see and actually be a true disciple of Christ and follow his example. Timothy, remember that you are not here to please others or look good for them and live up to everyone's expectations. Timothy, you are not here to please yourself. My dear soul, please remember that you did not purchase your own salvation. You have a Lord and Master called King Jesus. Therefore, stop trying to boost your ego or demand respect from others, thinking you are a self-made person. Timothy, your primary job is to walk in obedience to God and prove that you love Him. Remember, Timothy, God created you to love Him and not for the whole world to be loving you. Listen, my soul. You are not here to find out who your fake friends are and who your real friends are. You, my dear soul, are here to make sure that you are not a fake person in the eyes of a true God. So, Timothy, get yourself together. Kick the self-pity, selfishness, and stubbornness out of you and be determined to walk in obedience to God. So, if you read that, you speak to your soul, you know, if you're not enough, you know, you can watch the video again and just go through that part again. Ask the Holy Spirit for you to walk in obedience to God and obey His commandments and enable you to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength and all your mind. Would you take time and really evaluate yourself, even after this study, today evening, just as this is finished, I want you to just take time, spend time in His presence, set the records right, talk to God, tell Him things you need to change, certain things you might have to bring in front of God, as you know what, Lord, I've been living so much and worried about, actually I've been abiding in people. Why? For them to love me. I want to abide in them so that their influence abides in me. Are you influenced more by people or are you influenced by God? Is your decisions you make, the walk you walk, everything, is it influenced by people? The way you dress, the way you talk, is it influenced by people or are you influenced by God? You got to ask yourself. I hope you understood. I hope you understood from this study. I hope you learned something from John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2. I hope it enlightened you of how we need to live our lives. And I want you to take time this week. Make a conscious effort. If you have been a person who've been sitting always online, watching one sermon after another sermon, you've got so lazy, you've got so laid back, I want you to make a conscious effort to make it to church, to worship together as one body. As everyone comes together to worship God, it is a compulsory thing that we need to get together as one body and worship Him. It's very important. I want you to make a conscious effort to make it possible. Make it to church. Come together as one body. As we worship Him, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for this time. Thank you, God, for each and everyone who has joined in and watching, Lord. Lord, I pray, God, that you will speak to each one of us. Show us, Heavenly Father, where we have gone wrong. Where are certain things we need to put right? Lord, if we have been abiding in people more than abiding in you, and we have been influenced by people more than being influenced by you, Lord, if we have not spent time and invested time in building that intimate relationship with you, Lord, forgive us, Father. Lord, reveal to us where our weaknesses are, where we need to put things right. Holy Spirit of God, I ask that you will strengthen each one watching to be able to find that time to spend time with you, to build a relationship with you. Lord, it's only you and you alone who can do that. Lord, I pray, help us to abide by your commandments, your principles, your boundaries that you have set in our relationship. Because, Lord, that is how we show how much we love you and honor the relationship with you, God. I thank you, God, for this time. I pray, Lord, you will bless each one watching. And let me have a tremendous weekend ahead, Father. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you, church. I hope to catch you again next week on part 3 on light, love, and life. All right, I hope to catch you. Be blessed. I will catch you next week.
This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart, I worship you. And all I have within I give you praise, and all
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence, living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I desperate.